Next on Unsolved Mysteries. A routine traffic stop escalates into a life or death struggle for police chief Greg Adams. The attacker is still on the run. A Utah teenager disappears from her home, leaving behind a string of email accounts that may be the link to an online predator. We know that this boy is a genius. So is this girl. However, the reason for their striking brilliance remains a fascinating mystery. And Alice Aruda's family celebrated her marriage to David Vieira. 14 years later, Alice is dead, and her family is looking for the killer, her husband. Our team continues to track crimes, wanted fugitives, and tales of the paranormal. Perhaps you can help. I'm Dennis Farina, and this is Unsolved Mysteries. Saxonburg, Pennsylvania, 34 miles northeast of Pittsburgh. It's a small town full of tree-lined streets, civic pride, and people who feel safe. So 16-year-old Tiger Freeling didn't know what to think when he heard gunshots outside of his bedroom window one afternoon.
Mom! Hey, Mom!
My son was up in his bedroom, and he came down and he said, Mom, I heard someone shooting outside. And I said, Tiger, don't say that because, you know, it's hunting season. I said, don't joke around about it. And he said, no, somebody was fighting and shooting. So I went out to the door and I looked and I saw someone laying in the bushes.
Who's over there? Who is it?
Midge was horrified to discover her friend, Saxonburg Police Chief Greg Adams, covered in blood.
And he said, I've been shot. Help me. And I said, who did this to you? And he said he didn't know. So then I just happened to look up our driveway and I saw a white car pull away. I didn't see the man that was driving it. I just saw a figure. And I said, you'll be okay, you know. You'll be fine. And he said, no, I think you better pray for me. He said, I don't think I'm going to be. And I think that he knew he was dying.
Greg had been shot twice and beaten severely. He did not survive. 31-year-old Greg Adams left behind a wife, two young children, and a grieving community.
A loss like that is not describable. It's devastating. That's it. It's just devastating.
The state police soon arrived at the murder scene, the parking lot of the Agway feed store. There they found their first clue. A driver's license had been left at the scene.
Stanley J. Portis.
It's our belief that that came out of Greg's hand when he was shot.
Phillipsburg, New Jersey.
The other piece of physical evidence at the scene was the gun that was used to shoot Greg, and it was empty and void of any serial numbers. It was untraceable. We still have yet to trace the gun to see where it came from. But that operator's license with the name Stanley John Portis on it and a date of birth and an address in New Jersey was a piece of physical evidence that without that, we have no idea who shot Greg Adams.
Police immediately traced Portis's name to a cemetery. He had been dead for 32 years.
Stanley Portis, 1892 to 1948. I'll get a couple shots though while we're here.
We did our background on Stanley John Portis and found out that he had a wife. And when we contacted that wife, we found out that she was married to a subject named Donald Eugene Webb. And Donald Eugene Webb had totally taken on Stanley John Portis's identification.
Donald Eugene Webb was already well known to law enforcement.
He was a member of the Fall River Gang, a group that robbed stores and homes up and down the eastern seaboard. And now, he was on the FBI's 10 most wanted list for the murder of Greg Adams. That day, Greg Adams was working his last shift before taking his yearly vacation. He left the station just after lunch for a routine patrol.
Witnesses tell us the last they saw Greg was on Water Street, heading towards the intersection of Butler Street, when they, as well as Greg, observed a white Mercury Cougar not stop for a posted stop sign. This caught Greg's attention. Immediately, he pulled a U-turn on Water Street and proceeded after the white Cougar. Greg, losing sight of the vehicle upon coming around the turn, probably wondered where the white vehicle went, and at that point spied the white Cougar attempting to turn around in the Agway parking lot. He then immediately blocked the white Cougar in.
Most police officers are trained to approach a traffic stop from the rear. Greg didn't have that kind of an ability on this stop because of the positioning of the cars. He had to approach that vehicle from the front. He was naturally in a bad position.
Can I have your license and registration, please?
Sure, hang on. There you go.
I believe at that point in time, Webb got the drop on him. He's hit twice. The blood trails on the ground indicate that there was one heck of a struggle there. And Greg actually shoots with his gun. And that struggle took them a long ways through the Agway parking lot back to the Midge Freeling residence where they were found. Of course, Greg is a tough little competitor, but he loses his gun to Webb, and the gun's empty, and Webb just beat him with the gun.
The town of Saxonburg has built a monument to commemorate Greg Adams' life. Here, the grateful citizens have inscribed their thank yous to a man who gave his life protecting their community.
Every day we drive by the Greg Adams Memorial, that crosses your mind. Greg's in his final resting place, and Donald Eugene Webb's still out there in the great society functioning as a human being. Makes me sick.
This is what Donald Webb looked like in 1980. Today, he would appear more like these artist renderings. He is 5'9", weighs 165 pounds, and has brown eyes. He may also have a beard. Webb has two distinctive tattoos, the name Don on the web of his right hand and the name Ann on his chest. He is considered armed and extremely dangerous. If you have any information about this case, please log on to our website at unsolved.com. Next, a teenage girl spends hours chatting on the internet and then suddenly disappears. This man may know where she is. ...80 miles north of Salt Lake City in Hiram, Utah. Joanne Autry woke up at dawn. Her daughter, Tricia, usually a late sleeper, was not in her bedroom or anywhere else in the house. As Joanne's concern turned to panic, she frantically called her daughter's friends and sent Tricia's sisters to search the neighborhood.
When none of us found her, then I became really frightened. All of a sudden, there was this deep fear, deep knot of fear in my stomach, because it wasn't like Tricia to do this. And I knew that there was something gravely wrong.
Tricia's sudden disappearance had everyone worried. It seemed unlikely that she would run away, but Tricia did have a very active fantasy life, and she spent a lot of time on the internet. Could something that she discovered there have lured her away from her home? Like many teenagers looking for acceptance, Trisha found adolescence a painful experience.
She was a kid that was ostracized in school. The children made fun of her. She didn't have what she really wanted, and that was a really close friend, someone that she could confide all of her adolescent dreams in and be able to share those things with. So she was a pretty sad child from that standpoint, is that she just needed that one special friend.
Trisha often escaped her unhappiness by writing elaborate stories, which included secret liaisons with older men. 2 weeks before her disappearance, she told her family that she had started a new story. Every night, she typed furiously into the early morning hours. On the night she vanished, Trisha was, as usual, at the computer.
I'm going to bed.
Night. See you tomorrow.
Her sister Brianne was the last family member to see her.
For Trisha to disappear was totally out of character for her. And what I was hoping was to find in the story that she was writing some clue as to what she was thinking of, what her frame of mind was. And that's why I went immediately there to begin looking.
When Joanne turned on the computer, there was no story. Only a few pages of scattered thoughts. So what had Trisha been doing on the computer for all of those hours? Computer expert John W. Georgie examined the system and made several disturbing discoveries. Trisha had three separate email accounts and spent a lot of time in chat rooms. Even more alarming, all records of Trisha's recent activity had been erased.
Everything that possibly could be found of who she talked to or what she'd been doing on the computer in the recent frame of time was deleted. I figured Trish was taught how to delete these files because she did not, from what I was told by her mother, have the experience to know where these files were stored. And I took this as a very bad sign that, you know, obviously somebody was trying to cover their tracks.
But who could this mystery person have been? Trisha gave no hints to her friends or family that she had met somebody online. Neighbors, however, noticed suspicious activity near the Autry home on several occasions.
About 2 weeks before she disappeared, one of our neighbors had seen her get out of a red car on the corner, and what he thought was some suspicious behavior is the way she was walking back to the house from the corner, as if she didn't want to be seen. So that was our first report of a red car.
Another neighbor noticed something early on the morning Trisha disappeared.
The headlights from a car coming up the street kind of struck the bedroom window, got my interest. So I was looking out the window and I saw kind of economy type red car. The young man got out of the car and oh, he was nervous. First thing that popped in my mind, oh, somebody's sneaking out of the house. And after a few minutes, a lady was coming down the street and they walked to the car together and went on their merry way.
I believe that she could be seduced into thinking she found someone who needed her and could love her. I think that she was bait, good bait for a predator.
Hello.
2 hours after Trisha was seen getting into the red car, Glenda Tripp, a local convenience store employee, witnessed a strange incident.
Are you all right, honey?
Yeah, I'm okay, thanks.
She seemed really apprehensive and nervous. And she never acted like she was wanting to buy anything, but she kept kind of stretching her little head and looking out the window like she was looking for someone or watching for someone. I've seen her in and about the neighborhood, so I knew Trisha. I have no doubt in my mind that it was Trisha.
Trisha hung around for nearly half an hour. Then the employee looked up, and Trisha was gone.
For me as a mother, the greatest thing is this is a tiny person that I loved and nurtured and worried about, and I can no longer protect her. I don't know where she is. When I drive through town and I see things that we would have been sharing together
or activities come up that we commonly did together as a family, and she's not there, and there's no, I mean, it's sometimes it just, the grief just washes over you, and it takes your breath away.
Update. 6 months after Trisha's disappearance, local authorities became suspicious of a man named Cody Lynn Nielsen. He did maintenance work for a wildlife research group 8 miles from Trisha's home. Near the time of Trisha's disappearance, Nielsen had been seen using a backhoe to dig deep trenches and then refill them for no apparent reason.
We contacted a cadaver dog team out of Duchesne County here in Utah. And we brought the dogs up to this site, and they were real interested, and they hit what they call hit on this one area right here that we knew that our suspect had been digging.
Sheriff's Department investigators began to dig with their own backhoe.
When we got to about 10 feet, we found a human jawbone, which later was determined to be Trisha Autry's. It was just nothing short of a miracle that we found that piece of evidence in that big of a hole.
In other trenches, sheriff's deputies found more fragments of Trisha's remains, some that had been burned. For Trisha's mother, the news of the discovery brought great pain, but also some sense of relief.
Primarily because of our faith, we know where she is now. Where before we wondered, we would lie awake together at night and worry about whether she was in the cold or whether someone was hurting her. It's probably been very agonizing, but also very validating because we knew that she did not run away.
Cody Lynn Nielsen was sentenced to life without the possibility of parole for the murder of Trisha Autry. Next, how did this 12-year-old become such an accomplished piano player? It's the mystery of child prodigies. Who hasn't spent time struggling to learn a musical instrument, learn how to paint, or solve a complex math problem? Get ready to meet child prodigies. From an early age, they demonstrate mind-boggling talents in art, science, or music. But no one knows why. Queens, New York. At just 14, Jessica Constant looked like a typical teenager, but she was already a college student. Jessica had attended New York City Technical College since she was 12 years old.
Oh, I used to hate the first days because I would have to walk into class and everybody'd be staring at me. I was so scared, but now I'm used to it. No, I think he is. I want to become a doctor, but I'm going to become a nurse before. Microbiology and child psychology are the only two courses I have left before I enter the nursing program. Then after I do 2 years of that, I get my associate's degree. Then I'm going to go on to medical school.
But Jessica was interested in more than academics. She was also a talented cellist at the prestigious Juilliard School of Music. Jessica and her brothers, Daniel and Pierre, performed together as the Constant Trio. They have appeared at venues such as the Kennedy Center in Washington, D.C. Their talent is undeniable, yet they didn't inherit it from their parents.
Sometimes when I look at the kid playing, I wish I could be the one playing instead of having to listen.
I never thought I would have it in my own house. When I see the kids doing trios together, it's fantastic. It's kind of like a dream come true for me.
Carrollton, Texas is home to another American child prodigy, Albert Wong. Albert was so smart that he taught himself a wide variety of subjects from college textbooks. He is a skilled violinist and a world-famous concert pianist. And Albert is a genius in science as well as music.
It's very rare when you find a musical prodigy. It's very rare when you find a child who is so talented at academic work that they need to move at such a rapid pace. The combination of those two things in one child is extremely rare. Each appears separately, infrequently. The combination appears almost never.
Albert Wong first displayed his extraordinary talent when he was just 3 years old. By the time he was five, he had already won the grand prize in a Dallas piano competition for children up to age 18. Wanting to nurture their only child's natural gift, Albert's parents took him shopping for a concert grand piano.
To test the pianos, I believe I was playing a piece. It was about the third piano I was playing on. And then this gentleman just walked over.
So he came over, introduced himself, and said actually very directly, say that Albert is very talented and I know just the right teacher for him.
Albert began taking lessons and eventually studied with Earl Wilde, a former child prodigy himself. Wilde performed at Carnegie Hall to celebrate his 85th birthday. After the concert, he invited Albert on stage. Mr. Wilde stunned everyone, especially Albert, by announcing that Albert would perform that night.
Are you ready to play, Albert?
Hey, I had not touched the piano in 6 days. And I mean, I didn't even have a chance to warm my fingers.
Albert's performance captivated the audience. That same year, at age 10, Albert recorded his first CD. It received rave reviews.
The prodigy has always represented the unexplained. In the absence of an explanation that meets rational and scientific criteria, we look for an explanation wherever we can find one. And reincarnation is attractive because it seems to account for some of the unbelievable and unexplainable parts of the prodigy.
Albert himself does not dismiss the possibility of his own existence in a past life.
I must have done something good in order to have deserved this.
I'm hammering in your king from all sides, so there's no escape route.
Albert's parents quickly learned that he also had a gift for math and science. His mother was afraid that he'd get bored with a conventional education, so she gave up her career to homeschool him.
I used to get up at 3 or 4 in the morning to prepare myself to teach Albert fast enough. Now I don't have to do it because Albert is old enough to be independent. So my life is much easier now.
When Albert developed a strong interest in science, his mother searched for a tutor. She chose a physics professor.
That's X. So you have an inverted coordinate system in order to comply with the FN.
I think the biggest thing in terms of working with Albert is that you never have to say something twice. Whatever mistake he might make, he's made it the last time he's gonna make it.
Of the three sciences, physics, chemistry, and biology, it's my own belief that physics is the most central of all the sciences, that every other science branches from physics. Biology is physics applied to living organisms, and chemistry is physics applied to chemical reactions, atoms, molecules and macromolecules. Well, I love to study, I love to read books. I love studying Shakespeare's Romeo and Juliet. Every time I study it, I uncover new literary elements that are very tasty, delicious.
Where could Albert's talents have come from.
Neither his mom or my family had any clue or any relatives in the families who had ever been a musician or even good in one instrument at all.
We know that there have been amazing prodigy cases through history. So we know that from time to time, such individuals appear. What we don't know is what the causes underlying the appearance of prodigies might be. Are they genetic? Are they evolutionary? Are they cultural? Are they historical? Are they something that's a combination of all of those things? Those are questions we don't know the answers to. Although we hope to understand the prodigy better in the 21st century, it remains a mystery.
Next, all her life she was a prisoner, first of tradition, then of her husband. But finally, she was ready to make her escape. São Miguel Island, Portugal. In the main church on the island, the wedding of twin sisters, Alice and Georgina Arruda, seemed like a double blessing to their family. But one marriage was destined for tragedy. 14 years later, Alice would be dead and her husband David on the run. The same family members who attended Alice's wedding would be tending her grave. Alice Arruda's life was shaped by Portuguese tradition. Marriages were arranged. A daughter was brought up strictly to obey, first her father, and then later her husband. It was a devoutly Catholic world where only death could truly end a marriage. Alice and David were born in the islands west of Portugal, known as the Azores. When Alice was 9, her family immigrated to New Bedford, Massachusetts. Even in America, Alice's father was determined that his children would be brought up with traditional Portuguese values.
My dad was very strict with the girls. We weren't allowed to wear makeup, we couldn't wear shorts, and definitely we couldn't have boyfriends. You know, it was go to school, come home, do housework, and stay in the house. We were not allowed to even sit out on the porch. That's how strict he was.
When Alice was 12, a letter arrived from Portugal. It was from her 11-year-old cousin, David. To Alice's surprise, David was proposing that they be engaged. Cousins often married in traditional Portuguese families like the Arrudas, so the proposal was taken very seriously.
At first, my mom says, oh, you know, you're kind of young, and my father right away insisted that she should start writing to him because that was his family, and knowing that, you know, that'd be nice being married into the family, so he gave the okay on Alice. And she wrote back to David stating that they would be going out by writing.
The letters continued for 5 years. David and Alice never once talked on the phone. They didn't see each other until Alice and her family returned to Portugal for the wedding. David and Alice eventually settled near her parents in New Bedford. Although David spoke little English, he found work in a textile plant. Within a year, Alice was pregnant.
The marriage went off pretty good, like maybe I'd say about the first couple of months. And then, you know, already he was already starting with her. You know, she couldn't wear makeup. She couldn't do anything. You know, he was very jealous, very possessed of my sister.
7 years into their marriage, Alice and David had 3 children, but it was not a happy household.
David, vamos comungar.
Oh, come on, Dad.
David, já te disse, vamos comungar.
Não faz mal,
a mulher, senta-te aí. Mas quem é que manda aqui nesta casa?
She stayed with him because she figured, you know, he's the father of the kids, and that's how she was brought up. You know, you got to be with your husband, and that's the way it is.
Onde
tu vais? Fala comigo. Não tem jeito a fugir. Quando é que tu vais?
He used to always say, if you ever leave me, I'm going to kill you. There's no other woman in my, you know, for my life like you are. You know, you're a good mother, you're a good cook. And he always had threatened her that if she ever decided to leave him for anybody, that he would kill her. But we never took it seriously.
Mas já vi o que é que ele fez outra vez na minha cara? Não posso mais ver mesmo assim, Deus.
Sometimes she'd go up to my parents and tell my mom and dad, Ma, I can't take him anymore. He's always beating me up or for any little reason, and he's always beating up the kids. And my parents would always, like, tell her, you got to stay with him. He's your husband, you know. It's going to be a shame to the family if you divorce him. We don't believe in divorces, so they kept shoving it back to him.
Finally, after 14 years of abuse, Alice found the courage to defy her parents and her husband.
She finally felt strong enough to say, I can't take it anymore, and she decided to get him out of the house. She finally sat down and says, David, I can't take it anymore. I want you to leave.
David moved out, and Alice began to build a new life for herself. She enrolled in nursing school and began seeing another man. But David could not let go. He began to stalk Alice at work and at home, night and day.
David, tá aqui.
Tá a porta fechada?
Tá, tá fechada.
Her boyfriend went by the house to see her that morning. And David drove up and down, and I think he spotted the boyfriend's car at the house. And my brother-in-law couldn't take that.
Alice's boyfriend witnessed the attack and ran a mile to the nearest police station to get help. Alice had been bludgeoned with a tire jack and then stabbed 24 times with a butcher knife. By the time police arrived, the young mother of three was dead, and David Vieira was nowhere to be found.
We learned that he, in fact, had taken a bus from Fall River, Massachusetts to Boston, Massachusetts, and then from Boston to Canada. Someone matching his description did, in fact, get off a bus in Canada near Hamilton, Ontario. And from that point on, we were unable to find out where he went.
Update. As a result of our original broadcast, David Vieira was captured in Canada.
Our particular segment on that show aired our time here in New Bedford, Massachusetts, at approximately 8:50 p.m. By 9:03 p.m., I was receiving telephone calls from Canada right here into my office, with very good leads as to his whereabouts.
For at least 2 years, Vieira had lived in Montreal, where he was well known in the Portuguese community. He belonged to a neighborhood soccer team and worked at a local fish market. Vieira was returned to Massachusetts to stand trial for killing his wife. He pleaded guilty to second-degree murder and was sentenced to a minimum of 15 years in prison.
I've seen him apprehended and with handcuffs, and to me that was a sign of saying, thank God I can rest and my sister can also be at peace now that he's caught.
Coming up, when a reclusive woman dies, authorities discover she has a small fortune, and now they're looking for her relatives. In 1941, the United States was plunged into World War II. Like many others, 30-year-old Harry Young felt a call to duty.
There's a war going on. I need you to sign this paper.
Harry, I think it's a terrible idea for you to leave right now. I need you.
Harry wanted to enlist, but to comply with military regulations about soldiers with families, Harry needed Laura to agree.
I'll be back. Just sign the paper.
No.
Laura.
Harry walked out on his wife, never to return. He had no idea that she was pregnant with their second son, and he never found out. Harry died in action within 2 years of enlisting. Years later, Harry's oldest son, Albert, was researching the family tree when he found a newspaper article about his father's death. To his amazement, the obituary mentioned a daughter, but not Albert or his brother Jim.
Well, at first I thought that the paper made a mistake, which wasn't common. You know, papers do make mistakes, and I thought maybe that they had got the information wrong, and I had a copy made so I could go into it further.
Albert learned that after Harry left home, he became involved with another woman. Together, they had a daughter, Kathleen Mary Young, born while Harry was overseas.
Okay, sweetie.
Look, we can do nothing.
After Harry's death, the woman took Kathleen to Harry's parents, but they wanted nothing to do with either of them.
I have some of Harry's things. Would you like me to bring them over to you?
No, just send them.
Kathleen Mary Young grew up knowing very little about her two half-brothers, but Albert and Jim had been trying to find her for more than a decade. Update. On the night of our broadcast, Kathleen was watching. She recognized her family story and called our phone center.
It makes me feel good. It makes me feel like special in a way that they took the time in all those years that now that I know that they were looking for me.
The long separation ended when Kathleen and her family came to meet her half-brothers for the first time.
Albert, I knew I saw the film.
How you doing?
Fine.
When I hugged her, it was euphoria. It felt wonderful. I knew it was her as soon as she stepped out of the car. That's a Young.
For Harry Young's three children, the reunion meant a new beginning.
Hi, Jimmy. How you doing, kid?
Good.
After 50 years apart, they could finally build some memories together. We've all heard the stories. It seems that just about every town in America has a village recluse. In Portland, Oregon, it was a woman named Catherine Bennett. Catherine was an eccentric, nearly destitute pack rat. She dressed in men's clothing, rarely left her home, and refused to discuss her past with anyone. But when she died, Catherine Bennett left a small fortune and nobody to give it to. Little is known about Catherine before 1941. That year, she met a handsome young soldier named Gilbert Bennett. 6 months later, they were married. After World War II, Gilbert became a commercial photographer, and Catherine was his favorite subject.
Oh, yeah, this is the spot.
The two shared a love for the great outdoors and spent many days on the rivers of the Pacific Northwest.
They loved the outdoor life, and they fished every chance that they could get. Katie was an excellent fisherman. I think she was better than Gilbert.
Gil, I got one on.
They're very devoted to each other.
Yeah.
Truly.
Good girl.
They were inseparable. Every place they went together, and they fished together, and they hunted together, and what have you. I'm sure that they were very much in love with each other.
Gilbert and Catherine never had children. Instead, they built a loving, private universe for two. After 38 years of marriage, Gilbert died, and Catherine began to change.
When she lost Gilbert, she just lost everything, I guess. And I had talked to Katie, concerned about her future. And I asked her if she had any living relatives. And she said, no, she didn't have a family. She was raised in an orphan home, and she didn't know anything about a family. And she just withdrew. Some holidays, we asked her to come to dinner and stuff like this, and she wouldn't do that. And we just couldn't keep in contact with her too long as a result of this.
After 10 years alone, Catherine Bennett passed away. She was 80 years old. When no blood relatives could be located, representatives from the Oregon Division of State Lands went to sort out her estate.
Poor condition. Oh boy, look at this.
What a mess.
Her home was unkept, it was cluttered, it was dirty, it was flea infested.
How long has it been like this?
It had an odor, it was as if a hermit had lived there. Mr. Bennett's clothing was still draped over the back of the chairs in the bedroom. Our first job is to locate a will or locate heirs. And when we enter a home, we quickly sift through the personal papers, looking for letters, insurance policies, anything that might lead to an heir.
The investigators never found a will, but they did find piles of unopened social security checks, along with rare coins and two separate bank accounts. After her house was sold, the value of Catherine's estate totaled more than $125,000. But without a will and with no known blood relatives, the state of Oregon was forced to hold Catherine's money until her heirs could be found. Catherine was born in Kansas City, Kansas, in 1910. She told her in-laws that she was raised in a Catholic orphanage after the death of her parents. Before her marriage, she went by the name Catherine Uratovich. But in Gilbert's family Bible, her maiden name is listed as Bernard. The state of Oregon is looking for anyone who might be a blood relative of Catherine's and possibly entitled to all or a portion of her estate. Update. A distant relative of Catherine's was found and awarded half of the estate. Since no other relatives came forward, the remaining money eventually went to the Oregon State Treasury. This case is closed, but if you have any information about any of the other stories in the program, please log on to our website at unsolved.com.